So this has been a little series that we've developed on medical errors, and what we do is look at our own error cases, analyze them, and try to learn from our own experience. And Jennifer, we're going to turn to you now, and you have the floor to talk about your cases.
I initially was asked this, and I thought, gee, where should I begin? And I thought about the more complicated things, or I was fooled for a dehiscent superior semicircular canal and thought it was menieres and ignored a mild conductive component. And I thought, you know what, let me give the type of thing any of us might be seeing in practice, in a primary practice any day. So this was an 89-year-old active male for age, and he was seen in consultation, referred by his primary doctor, and he had, quote, dizziness and hearing loss. And it was not vertigo, no description, but this is typically the type of patient I get referred in, and it was just chronic imbalance, unsteady when he walked. He could walk unassisted. He had not fallen down. He had, in a typical thing, he knew he had some problem hearing, but it didn't bother him, and the family was a lot more bothered by it than he was, did not wear amplification. You asked, since he had some known hearing loss, I asked if there was an association with his dizziness and hearing loss, fullness, anything that made him think about his ears, and he said no. Past medical history, he had hypertension, no heart attacks, anything like that, no history of strokes, he'd never smoked, no history of migraine, family history of ears with simply hearing loss with age, some occupational noise exposure in the distant past, nothing recreational, nothing there. On physical examination, he was healthy. He came with a cane. A lot of times he used the cane when he came out of the house, but not at home. Family.
Hey, Jennifer, I'm going to have to get you to speed up just a little bit and try to get through this one because we got two other ones coming.
Okay.
Behind.
I'll say his physical exam was unremarkable for age with one exception, and he fell asleep a couple of times during my exam, which is not necessarily unusual for me, I guess. But the audiologist also had a note that she'd had to wake him up a few times in the sound booth for his audiogram. Audiogram didn't show up, but it was presbycusis, high frequency loss, normal low frequency. You might thought on my diagnosis presbycusis, presbystasis, age related. And what I recommended on the next slide, hearing aid evaluation, take some vasodilators. I like vestibular rehabilitation, encouraged him to use the cane, no further evaluation. Outcome, he fell 2 weeks later in his home. They took him to the emergency room. He had an MRI. He had 6 metastatic brain lesions. The primary was found to be a lung, non-smoker, and he was dead in 2 weeks from disease. Now, it wouldn't have changed the fact that he was not going to do well when he came in this late, but the fact that he fell asleep so much, not just kind of drowsiness with this, I thought through that. The audiogram, my office, it was enough. I shouldn't have ignored that, just something that was out of sync with generalized dizziness.
Any of his lesions in the posterior fossa, Jennifer, were they all supertentorial lesions?
They were supertentorial. He really did not have brainstem compression symptoms. When I saw him, nor explained on the scan, but just pressure.
Right. Tough. That's a tough case, right? Because there were nothing focal. There was no way that you could have known. It sort of raises the question whether you do need to image older folks, in which it's not clear exactly what the lesion is that's causing this dizziness. And
you want to save, Obamacare, everything else with this, but in retrospect, the fact that the sleeping there and with the audiologist and all, I should have done more, at least a V&G that would have picked up very abnormal central signs that would have led me to an imaging study or something, just so the family and he could have prepared.